Welcome to the Jimmy Star Show with Ron Russell, bringing you the good times in music, fashion, pop culture, and entertainment. We got a great show for you guys today. Before we get started, let's say hi to our cool, outrageous man about town co-host, Mr. Ron Russell.
Pretty boy, come sit closer to me. I can't see. I'm blind, but I can feel. And what I felt like 8 inches, and it felt so good. So why do you want to go after that blonde, blind bitch, the movie star, Sarah French? She hasn't got what I have to give you. And that's just all of my love, pretty boy. Leave Sarah French alone. She's just a demented bleach blonde. The bleach went to her brain. I don't care for that bitch. And if I see her, I'll scratch her eyes out of her head if she comes anywhere near you, pretty boy. Because I love you so much. Pretty boy. Yes, honey. Are you going to go after Sarah French and scare her again and make her run away? Good. Let the bitch run as far away as she can go. Because you're mine, pretty boy. I love you. Welcome to our crazy show.
You guys, we're going to have a great time today. We've got the cast and crew of Pretty Boy coming on, the brand new film by director Marcel Walz.
But first you have to see Blind, the first one, which I love, 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 love. It had me on the edge of my seat, and that Sarah French gave such a performance that I was freaking out from it. And it was scary, and it was weird to have a stalker in your house, and you're blind, and you don't know where he is, and he's always around you, behind refrigerated doors, in your bedroom. Oh, my God, it's the most frightening thing you could ever think of. Think of it, folks. You're blind, and some creepy, crazy fuckers in your house, maybe trying to kill you. And you don't know when he's going to do it. And if you're in the shower, he's watching you, probably playing with himself. But yeah, I mean, if Sarah French is in the shower and anybody's watching her, if they don't play with themselves, they're either gay or dead. But anyway, it's a freaky, scary movie, and I love it. It's one of the best films out there. I suggest you definitely see it. Now, Pretty Boy, that one I don't like because they left me hanging with Sarah running and I was very upset because the film was good, but the ending was very Hitchcockian and I didn't care for it. So I smacked Marcel Walz around a little bit for that one. I gave him a couple of black and blues. Oh, he loved it. Trust me. He wanted more. You know, those Germans are into S&M. But anyway, Pretty Boy is definitely the follow-up. Now I spoke with Joe. And Joe is the writer. And Joe gave me a little bit of the story of Three. I cannot wait to see what happens to that blonde bitch, Sarah French, who's trying to take Pretty Boy away from me in Three. So let's get on with it.
Enough. So hold on. We've got a chat room full of people. What's up,
let's
everybody?
Go, chat room.
What's up in the chat room? We want to welcome Teresa Sabin, Angela Joseph, Terry Gerald, Backpack John, Casey Plott, Don Hinton. I don't know who else is in there because it's going by too fast. But you guys, we're going to have a really fun. Oh, Cindy Lady Lake is in there. That's going to be a lot of fun today. With
and
the
Pretty Boy
crew.
Is really pretty. He's a good-looking guy. Too bad he's fucked up in the head. You know, a girl's always looking for another husband.
It's funny as hell. So we're going to have a lot of fun. Before we bring on our guest, you guys, real quick, we're going to play the trailer for the very first movie, Blind.
Which is great.
Then we're bringing on the cast and crew to talk about the sequel, which is called Pretty Boy.
Which is scary.
And you guys are going to like love it. It's a very, very good. It's a very, very good film.
And heads flying and eyeballs falling out and all kinds of body parts. Falling all over. It was disgusting. Ugh.
I loved it every second of
it. Was
so anyway, here we go, you guys. Go ahead, Roxy. Let's play, everybody. Watch and
Roxy,
check out.
This baby.
This is the trailer for the first movie, Blind.
Good.
The anniversary of my surgery is coming up, and it's just a reminder of what I lost. I always wanted to work on a comedy. It was the last genre on my bucket list.
Sorry I'm late. You're my last delivery. You're Megan Summers.
That was a fun role.
I've seen Fogstorm at least 20 times. The sequel sucked, though. Why weren't you in it?
I retired.
Nobody's gonna believe this.
Yes, I think someone broke into my house. Film was my life. Some of my favorite childhood memories are tied to the scene. I dreamed of seeing myself on the screen. And now, I can't see myself at all. I think I love you. 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 I think I love you.
Shit, I got like shivers again.
Is that not scary shit or what? I mean, I'm sitting here freaking out.
And we even know what happens.
No, and we know the movie, but it really is in the genre of the films of years ago when they made a movie that wasn't stupid with just things flying all over like eyeballs, where it has a story, it has a plot, and the direction by Marcel Walz is so phenomenal. Marcel is probably the greatest director that I've met since I worked many years ago when I was 19 with, what was his name I worked with?
The director? Yeah, I forgot.
Oh shit, he's the biggest director in the world. Oh my God, how could I forget his name? Anyway, I would compare Marcel Walz to him. And his name was, the movie was That Kind of Woman, and I was directed by, oh, the biggest director in the world. Oh my God, how could I forget? Anyway, Marcel, is it Jimmy's?
Sidney Lumet.
Marcel Lumet. Lumet or Lumet, either way. I am comparing you to Sidney Lumet, who is probably one of the best directors of our time.
Definitely, Marcel's definitely the best indie
director. And Sarah French, I must tell you, gave a wonderful performance. Every time I see her, I keep boring her to death by telling her the same story over and over again, which I will tell once more. So, Sarah, don't get nasty. driving in to see this movie at the red carpet, I said to Jimmy, Sarah French can't act. She's all tits and ass. Every time we see her, she's like nude, squirming around. And she's going to carry a movie? How embarrassing, how sad for Sarah. Well, 10 minutes into the movie, I turned to Jimmy. I said, oh, my God, she's the most incredible friggin' actress we have today. The girl can really act. Well, she held it through Blind, and she certainly did a wonderful job in Pretty Boy, which is the sequel to Blind. You know, like I told Sarah, most actresses love to scream and squirm, act like they're getting laid or they got a hot poker iron up their ass or something weird. Sarah laid there. And Sarah imploded, and she took you with her, into her. You felt her fear. Because you know what, folks? When you're frightened, you really don't move. It's called scared stiff. And that's what Sarah does. She laid there so frightened that I felt so frightened for her, I wanted to run into the camera and pick her.
Don't I want to bring him in. You're I not
direct.
Bring him in.
Fuck you. Don't direct me.
I'm bringing him
I
in.
I am going to crucify you at Halloween.
We're bringing him in, though, right now.
I want to do a big, big build-up because these people deserve it. They did a big, big film, and they deserve a big, big build-up.
So, Roxy, let's bring in Marcel and Sarah, and then we'll bring in everybody else. But I want to bring in Marcel and Sarah real quick first.
The reason the film is so good.
Hey!
Look at you, Marcel. You got your shirt open again. You love to show those
just
nipples,
for you,
don't
just
you?
For you? Just for you. Just for you.
Oh, you love to show the ninnies. I know that. Sarah, why don't you do the same? Oh, she did already. Look, she's got ninnies out there, too.
Only because I've been running errands all day. I ain't got time to dress up.
Oh, it's good. It's good. No, we have a guy in England who watches our show every week, Dave. And if you girls, come on, Dave gets crazy. He's like a sex maniac. He's a dirty old man.
Oh,
he's a
filthy dirty. Yeah, say Dave. Yeah. So now we want to welcome.
And you and Sadie Katz are his favorites.
So now we want to welcome to the Jimmy Star Show with Ron Russell, blind and pretty boy director Marcel Walz, and Sarah French, the star of both films as well as many other films. We want to welcome you guys to the show. We're going to talk to you just for a couple minutes, and then we'll bring everybody in. But I thought it would be a lot of fun because Pretty Boy. So Pretty Boy is the sequel to Blind. You guys, can people actually see it yet or no? I know it's at all the film festivals, but can they actually see it?
Well, we're doing the festival run right now. But the movie's coming out in the first quarter of next year. So a little bit be patient, but then, yeah.
You had some nerve with that film. You left me in the theater saying that fucking Marcel Walz, when I get him, I'm going to beat the shit out of him. Look what they did to us. They left us hanging. I can't believe. Where the fuck is Sarah going?
Here's the thing. We did kind of the same thing in the first one, but for the second one, we got more of an ending. A little bit.
No. The first one you left.
No, don't spoil anything.
That's kind of what we like to do. We like to make you think you're going to get
it. I don't like it. I don't care what you like. I don't care what you like. I don't like it. I want to know what happened to Sarah French.
So we can't wait for the next one.
The first ending was romantic and quiet and soft. The second ending was screaming. You're like saying, oh my God, run, bitch, run,
well,
run,
the,
run.
Yeah, well, bitch. the end of Blind, it left you with a cliffhanger. So you didn't know what happened or what was going to happen to Faye at the end of the film. So I think with Pretty Boy, we kind of did the same thing. Because, you know, that's our MO, I guess.
Now I can't wait for you to shoot it, and then you have to edit it, and then I have to see it. And I'm 81 years old. I may not be here when 3 comes out.
Wait a second. Dave Hughes just joined us. Say hi to Dave Hughes, Sarah. He's our resident bird.
Hi, Dave.
Sarah, do me a favor, Sarah. Open your jacket a little bit. Just for Dave, a little bit.
Oh, I see how it is, Ron, Mr.
No, just for Dave.
But no, she can really act, but open your shirt.
just for Dave.
Like one or the other.
I love it.
Because Dave can't breathe. He thinks you are the sexiest girl in the world, which is true, you are. And you are very sexy and blind, even though that movie left me hanging and I'm upset about it.
So hold on. Both of you guys, we have a chat room full of people. So say hi, the two of you. Say hi to everybody in the chat room.
Hi, guys.
And Dawn says she's seen the movie 3 times, I guess Blind. And she says, tell Marcel thank you. Dawn's fabulous.
I love the movie. I don't lie. I never blow smoke up anybody's ass and I don't bullshit. That's why nobody likes me, because I tell the truth.
This is true.
But Blind to me was a work of art. Who was that fucking fag agreed? That Blind, Marcel agreed. I'm gonna wait till I see you. I'm gonna tweak your nipples and get channel 3.
So hang on, you guys. I want to
the Germans love SM, right? You said that.
Yes. I said that. They do. They're all into kinky shit.
So you guys, what we're going to do, first of all, let me tell you the quick synopsis, you guys. Yeah. This is the Pretty Boy synopsis now. A mass killer named Pretty Boy takes a blind woman, that's Sarah French, from her home in the Hollywood Hills and crashes a Valentine's Day party where the bloodshed continues. It's very kind of like Friday the 13th-ish, but way cooler.
It's better than Friday the 13th.
Well, I just said it's way cooler.
Cooler doesn't make sense. Better is better. Cool is like this. Refrigerator.
So you guys, some of the other films Marcel has also, besides Blind and Pretty Boy, he did Blood Feast and Rootwood and a bunch of movies in Germany.
I wasn't nuts about Rootwood.
Oh, I loved Rootwood.
No, I didn't care for Rootwood. Rootwood doesn't come anywhere near Blind or Pretty Boy.
They're different.
Blind and Pretty Boy, there are no other movies out there that can even touch it, come close to it.
So let's give props.
It's their masterpiece work.
So you guys, let's give some props. Marcel directed it. It was written by Joe Netter. We want to give props to Joe Netter because he's fabulous.
Joe is a sweetheart of a guy, and one day he may marry Sarah French, I wish.
And then the composer is Claus. How do I pronounce Claus's last name?
Oh, well, that's very German name. So, Freudner.
Okay, Freudner.
And he's a hot-looking guy, too.
We want to give a shout-out to Rüdiger. How do I say Rüdiger's last name? Rüdiger. Kermit. Okay, because
so who's the guy, that we met at
Rüdiger.
Oh, Rüdiger's the hot guy.
Yeah, he's cool. We love him.
Oh, Rüdiger in that suit. Oh, he could turn any girl on.
We also want to give a shout out to the production designers, Terry Love, Robert Lucas, and Marcel, just because I know
and
them.
And Joe
That's
Castro, who did
out.
All the heads.
He's coming
stuff.
On.
Oh, Joe belonging. Killed it.
Joe killed it. And
who was the woman that did, who played, you know, the one with the big long speech was fabulous.
She's on that show.
Pretty Boy. What's her name?
Heather.
She's getting ready to come on.
Oh, she was fabulous.
So hold on.
She really, I mean, that she had like pages and pages of dialogue.
Well, yes.
Me and I would have been on sentence three on 49 takes. 49 takes. Let's do sentence three.
So before we bring him in, I want to do just, I want to give everybody props. So here's the cast, you guys. Sarah French, Jed Rowan is Pretty Boy, Devanny Pinn, Heather Grace Hancock, Jake Red, Andrew Rohrbach, Robert Felstad Jr., Fritzy Marth, Sarah Nicklin, Ben Stauber, Tyler Gallant, Dave Sheridan, Maria Olson, Robert Russler, Joe Netter, Joe Castro.
Dave.
Not Joe Netter wrote it. He's not in it, you guys. Castro.
Dave
and makeup head of makeup, Kwame Head, who's going to be here also.
Is Dave Sheridan going to be there?
No.
I love Dave Sheridan.
He's great. He's great.
He stuck up for me in that incident that happened in that movie I walked off of. And he stuck up for me. You know, in our business, people are so afraid to stick up for the victim because the fucking director won't hire them again. But Dave didn't give a shit because Dave is a star and he goes from movie to movie to movie and he couldn't care less. He was there in my corner and I love Dave for that always.
You guys,
I will love him always.
Real quick, say hi to Angela Joseph.
Hi, Angela. Hi, Angela.
There you go. She's
now
always,
listen.
Now we're going to bring in the other people.
Wait, I just want to say something. All of my fans out there, yes, I have fans, Marcel. all of the people who love Ron Russell's show, not the Jimmy Star show, screw that bag. No, the Ron Russell show, please go out and how do they get your movie? Do they buy it? Or do they get it on YouTube or some shit? Where is your movie?
Well, it's on iTunes, Amazon, and Tubi TV. It's everywhere.
Okay, so I'm going to say to you, Halloween night, if you're not out trick-or-treating, or out tricking like Marcel will be, you have to definitely watch this film. Can we watch both blind?
No, Pretty Boy's not out till next
Pretty
year.
Boys, oh, next year?
Yeah,
first quarter. I got to wait another year to get... Okay,
No.
Okay.
No, I'm going to talk to Joe. Joe's got to tell me the ending. I may not make it.
Yeah. You will.
You'll make it.
Anyway, I suggest you get this film for Halloween, turn off the lights, and wear Pampers because you definitely will piss yourself at certain parts. You will urinate all over your sofa, and you don't, because it smells. You don't want to do that. So wear Pampers. And you guys, when you see Sarah French, if you decide to, you know what? Have Kleenex nearby because you don't want to stain the furniture either.
Oh my God!
But anyway,
listen,
this is Hollywood, honey. We sell
I'm
it
used
to every.
It.
We sell it. We sell it to.
Every, used to it.
Wait, we sell it to everybody.
All right, let's
Hollywood.
Bring on the people. So who else do we have in there, Roxy? Go ahead and bring on. I don't know who you've got, but let's bring.
I want Heather because she's wonderful.
There's Heather. Oh, hey, Heather.
There's Heather. 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 Heather.
There's Sarah. Oh, hi, Sarah. There's Kwame.
Hello.
Hi, there's Joe Castro.
Hey. They're all in at once. Let me get Heather.
Hey. Wait. First.
Oh, you're directing again,
first.
You might have
called. Oh, and Robert. Hello, Robert. Robert. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Hello.
So first thing, before we do anything, we want to all wish him, Devanny Pinn, congratulations on becoming a mommy. And we missed you the other night. We saw you in the pictures at that thing the other night, but we didn't see you there. And so congratulations, and also congratulations on Pretty Boy, because you were, like, awesome.
Heather. Wasn't Heather, tell me. Heather, now, yes. Tell me. This is for Heather. Tell me the truth. I know who the fuck she is. Okay. You direct me one more time. See those doors? You're going to go right through them fucking head first.
Hey, Kwame,
oh,
real quick. You're
him.
Mute. Tommy,
I'm married. Listen, would you all shut the fuck up. Would
there
you all chip in? Give me money so I could divorce this faggot. I can't. I'm going straight. I'm going to marry Su Wong. This way I'm worth $250 million. I'm no schmuck. But anyway, Heather, the truth.
Yes.
How many takes did it take for you to deliver what you delivered, because it was unfucking believable?
Oh, thank you so much. I don't know. I feel like I could hand this to Marcel. I want to say maybe three. It was pretty fast.
Oh my God, that's awesome. Three takes with all those lines.
Three takes for that? I would still be working on it if I were in that shot.
I mean, the irony is that I have all my lines down, but I couldn't tell you where, like,
well,
I couldn't
you
tell you shit about where Trader Joe's
is. Your performance really made the movie happen also. Your performance really... I was getting a little bored with it, you know, watching Sarah, the beautiful thing, laying there, breathing heavy. You know, I mean, being a gay guy, that could be boring after a while. And then Heather came on, and Heather, you know, interested me. Well, you know, Sarah, I've seen you So often I know you in person.
So real quick, let's go around. Let's go around with Kwame, and then goes Kwame, Sarah, Heather. Hang on, Joe, Devanny, and Robert. Tell us who you are, and tell us what character you played, real quick, or what you did with the film, since Kwame was the makeup guy.
Hi, I'm Kwame. I don't normally do this. I know you guys usually just want to talk to the famous people, but I helped do the makeup.
I can see.
I work with Marcel all the time. Joe Castro was a great person to have on the team. The talent was just, you know what? This is one of my favorite films to work on, to be quite honest. So I did makeup, passing it on.
There you go.
You know, Joe Castro's a little twisted in the mind. You know that. In order for him to create the things that he creates,
but that's what makes a good horror movie.
You got yes.
No, you have to be a little twisted and bent out of shape, because Joe Castro makes some of the most disgusting, revolting, horrible creatures I have to look at. I could throw up from them. But that's what makes movies, right, Joe? How are you, Joe? I love you, baby.
I love you. This is my.
You know,
I want you on my movie.
Oh. I want you on my movie. You're going to have to do a lot of blowing up in pieces on my movie, The Gift of Magic, with Lainey Kazan and I. So when we're ready, we're calling you.
Call me. Anything you
want. Nobody does it better than Joe Castro, trust me. He is a magician with makeup and rubber and dildos or whatever he does.
I couldn't do Pretty Boy without this amazing team. I mean, Kwame really came in and helped me, you know, not only with the technical skill, but also with the knowledge he had of you know, being on set, on other sets, and he brought that to the table as well when it came to the gore and stuff. And so we worked together as a team to make this happen. Yeah.
I loved what you did with the big friggin' rat. That rat was ugly. It was almost as ugly as the director.
So I want to go real quick back to Kwame real quick too, though, because you know, you said you usually want to talk to the celebrities, but you're like a celebrity makeup person. I went on your IMDb. You've worked on great projects. You're a superstar in the world of makeup. So we want to give you props for that. And let's go on over to Sarah. Sarah, go, you next.
Hi,
Sarah. Oh God, I am.
Oh, not you, Sarah.
Oh, sorry.
Sarah Nicklin.
Oh shit.
Sarah French.
I love you, okay?
Sarah N. You go.
Sarah.
Okay. Hi, I'm Sarah. Also a Sarah. I play Jill in the movie, which is the deaf character that's killed off at the beginning.
I love it, and you were fantastic. Actually, everybody was fantastic. So let's go to you, Heather.
And I'm Heather Grace Hancock, and I play Raina.
There you go. And Robert, go.
I'm Robert Felstad Jr., and I play Gary.
Okay, so I have to tell you something. First of all,
Wait.
I think that you're a great actor, Robert. And I saw another movie that you did, which was really not a good movie. But you and Sadie Katz were in Hanukkah, and Joe Netter was good in it, but everybody else kind of like really wasn't too good. But you made the movie like bearable. You and Sadie made the movie bearable. You were really good in it.
When the Jews saw Hanukkah, they made the sign of the cross. Ari was at a horrible movie. But anyway, you guys were all good in this film.
That was the first time I was able to, like, trusted with, like, a lead role.
Oh, it was horrible. It was terrible. The directing was terrible. The lighting was terrible. The dialogue was terrible. The story was from outer space. I mean, it was just a piece of shit. I would never go see it, and I wouldn't recommend anybody else to go see it.
But you were really good in it.
Who cares? I like what he did in Blind. Forget the other one. Hanukkah's not...
No,
shouldn't,
Pretty Hanukkah, Boy.
Pretty my boy. Big break.
Hanukkah
cares?
Should never be
yes.
in this. Get rid of Hanukkah in your resume. Leave Pretty you were fabulous. You made up for it in Pretty Boy.
What happened to Devanny? Did she disappear? Is Devanny still there? I don't see her.
She got frightened away.
Okay, well, we were going to talk to her and tell her next. So Marcel, you did a really cool thing. I mean, I guess everybody got killed in Blind anyway, so you really couldn't have a lot of the same cast. But how did you come about finding all these fabulous people to star in Pretty Boy?
Well, actually, both of us were friends, which is great. So, and we did a casting, and all of the cast we had in the movie was, they're just brilliant and great. So that's why we choose them. We choose Sarah for the deaf character. That was actually her idea.
Oh, very good. It was very believable, too.
She did a... Thank you. Oh, my God. It was, It was out of this world. It was great. So, yeah.
Well, you know, you
let's go back to Devanny because she just showed up again.
Let me talk to Marcel for a minute. Wait. I want to ask Marcel a question. You interrupt me one more time.
I know, but Devanny
came
back.
See this mic? It's going to go down your throat.
Okay, but Devanny just came back. We want to, like, introduce her.
Well, she's going to stay there. She has to pee. She went to pee. She came back. Now she's okay. Marcel, how do you compare yourself to American directors? In other words, what do you bring to us from your country that we're lacking in our country? Because there's definitely a finesse about your directing.
Well, that's hard to say for me. I think other people probably could say that better or see a difference. I would say I bring probably an European style to it a little bit, but I don't know. It's hard for me to say.
That's what I must have recognized, the European style. I like that. You know, I'm in a lot of these movies, and of course you know my opinion of half of them I'm in. Ugh. And shooting it in a week without a mark, without a key light, without a director, without anything, you just go out there and read lines. It's exactly that. You're reading lines, and the movie stinks because when I watch some of these films, I see them reading their lines. There was a time when I was young where we acted, and we didn't have to have 100 lines. It was like Norma Desmond said, we had faces. We could do an expression that said 7 lines. Unfortunately, actors today don't do that, with the exception of my Sarah French. Sarah French can give you one look, and you got a paragraph. You know what she's suffering and feeling and her fear and her wants and her whatever. She knows her script and she knows her acting. I'm such a fan of Sarah French's. I mean, I never was before. I liked her as a person. Who gives a shit about her acting? But now I'm such a fan of hers. I will always go see Sarah French in a film. And Marcel, certainly, when you direct a film, the only thing I didn't like about both of your movies was that I wasn't starring in it with my name above the title. Making the film an Academy Award nominee film, which it would have been probably Academy Award winner, but you know, sour grapes, Marcel. So.
But also, here's one other thing. I mean, directing is one side, but when you have all those actors and everyone came super prepared and they created a character, that helps a lot. And that's exactly what happened on Pretty Boy. Every single actor, every single character, they created something. Heather or Deb. I mean, actually everyone created a super nice character and so believable. So that is actually easier for me than actually to work with them,
Marcel,
or to give directions. So it's not, you know,
Marcel,
that is
Marcel, let me give you an erection.
Again?
An actor is only as good as their director. If you have a shitty director, your acting stinks. This is what Betty Davis said. Betty Davis fought Warner Brothers for directors that were good because a bad director would have made her performance bad. Betty Davis, the queen of acting, said this. And I believe this. You direct so well that your actors do what you say and look good. All right? Now, do you have an erection from all of that?
Also, on the other hand, if you have an actor in front of a camera or someone or a person who is in front of the camera and that person can't act at all, that's also a challenge then. But I got lucky.
Fire them.
But you got good ones.
No,
that's
if they can't act,
so
you fire them.
That's exactly the thing. I got the best one. So every single one brought so much to the table, brought so much life and character development to that character they played. That was just a dream. That I was in heaven, so it was easy for me. I just wasn't said.
And the material is just as important too.
Hey, Joe Netter! Joe Netter!
Listen. Let's talk showbiz. Let's talk showbiz, okay? If the lines and the director are not in sequence, are not in together, you have a problem. Because if the director doesn't understand the line, how can he teach it to the actor? Number one. I've been in the business 64 years. I may be a dizzy queen, but I know what the fuck I'm talking about when it comes to this shitty business. This business stinks, and I've been with the best, and I've been with the worst. But a good director, listen, I in my movie, The Gift of Magic, we have Michelle Kanin, who is a fabulous director. That's the wife of Sean Kanin. The reason I chose her is because she's Italian, married to a Jew, and Sean Kanin is Jewish, and my character, Lainey Kazan, is Jewish, and I play an Italian mafia. So she can direct because she knows the nuance of the characters. She knows what it's like to be around Italian mafia, and she knows what it's like to be around Jews from Brooklyn. So she is going to direct my movie beautifully. And that's what I think you do. You learn your characters, and you know ethnically where to put them and sort of to direct them. My feelings, yeah. Maybe I'm wrong.
Well, yeah, but on the other hand, then you have you need a good script. I mean, there's all there. You have if you have a shitty script, you can do whatever, but it will suck, yeah. You know. But and that's a good thing. So that's why I stopped writing scripts, because that's some, you know, I have an idea, but I can't write. That's
you're not a writer.
So that's why I'm super happy.
You're a visionary.
Joe and I, we're such a perfect.
Oh, Joe writes beautifully. Yeah. No, you have a vision, and you
okay.
You
so
see
hang
it.
On. So again, first of all, Kwame, we're going to you for a second because you've got all kinds of fans in the chat room, and they want to know what your Instagram handle is so they can like follow you. First of all, so if you could tell everybody your Instagram handle so they could follow you, that would be great.
It's head like head.
With like give head.
Yeah.
Wait,
yeah.
Head like, what? Well, like what's the
get,
rest of it?
Head. Get head.
Didn't let him finish it.
What is it? Like get head.
No. Head
Studios.
Head Face Studios,
LLC.
You guys. LLC. Head Face head Studios, LLC. There you go.
See, I would have put get head before it.
I just want to say that the thing that makes Marcel different, because I work with a bunch of people, is he brings trust. He knows when to direct and when to go, all right, I hired you to do this, so I'm going to let you do this. And you see it with actors, you see it with the crew. He's worked with a couple different crews throughout the times that I've worked with him. And he just brings trust. And you find that's a rare thing in this entertainment industry, especially in the horror industry. You get a director and they want
to. But that's the thing you need. That's the thing you need. There's always a reason why you hire someone. That's the reason why I hired that camera guy. That's the reason why I hired that actress, because I like what those people bring to the table. So they should also tell me what they can do, what they want to do, and what they want to create.
That's a director. I was on the brig. What was it? The movie that we're going to Saturday night. Everybody should go to. It's Joseph Kelly's Clown Motel. 15, I think, or 22, whichever one it is. And it's going to be red carpet night. I was on that set, and, you know, Joe was a great director, but kind of boring. He really didn't tell me what to do. Joe was kind of like smiling a lot, looking pretty. So there was a scene where he was supposed to come to the door, and we're standing out there for quite some time, like 3 or 4 hours. And I thought, not really, but I banged on the door. Well, this is not in the script. And I said, hey, Kelly, come on, open the door. And I thought they were going to have a stroke, but they loved it and they left it and they used
it. So hang on, we got to
wait a minute, because it needed it. Sometimes an actor has to tell the director.
If any of you guys can hear me, I love you all.
Yes.
Can you hear us? Hey, Devanny, can you hear us, Devanny?
No? Everyone go watch it. I'm going to work on getting technology that actually works. And I let you guys carry on, and I will watch this on playback.
Hi, Devanny. We love you, and congratulations. Sorry we don't have a good connection, but we loved you on our show, and we loved you in the film. Bye. I don't know if she can even see us, unfortunately. Okay.
She couldn't see us. Anyway, to complete that conversation, sometimes the director has to understand that the actor may know a little bit better than what the script writer or the director did. If it plays, it plays. If it doesn't play, of course, you edit it out. What do you think about that, Marcel?
Yeah, I think that's true. And because at one point, maybe an actor spends way more time with a character, but that's best case scenario. they spend a lot of time, they even create a backstory for themselves. That happens a lot of times, and that's a good thing. So, and that happens, like, I have to say it again, on the set on Pretty Boy, everyone came super freaking prepared. And best example is Sarah Nicklin. She said, well, I have that what I can do, and what do you think about that? It was great. So it made sense, and that's what I like. So people spend time and think about the characters, and that's a win.
I also think too, it was really good because all you guys were really good. And problems with a lot of the indie horror films are they'll have two or three good actors, and then they'll have like, you know, 50 people who paid $20 to like have a role, and they all suck, and they can't act, which makes the whole movie stink. And that there's no weak links. There's no weak links in your cast. Everybody was really good. Everybody turned a stellar performance, and I want to congratulate you on that.
When you have a tight script, you know what a tight script is in the business. When you have a tight script, you can't really go places, and the only place you could go is in the script, and that makes the character work. So a tight script makes a tight actor. A tight actor is a good actor. Marcel was lucky in both these movies to have hired good people.
So let's talk to everybody. Let's let everybody talk a little bit. Robert, tell us something fun about the film. How did you get involved? And just give us some kind of insight into it. And then the rest of you guys can be thinking about something to say, because your character, you're really good. I mean, I've only seen you in two films, but even in the film that was a bomb, you were really, really good. So I think you've got great acting chops. So tell us a little bit about Pretty Boy.
I mean, I come from the comedy and like sketch and commercial world mostly. So Hanukkah is my first horror thing, but I was supposed to be like the funny guy. So
the whole movie was funny.
Yeah, well, that, I had to just be the person that is the mouthpiece for the audience, which is what I'm kind of used to. In this, I'm more of a sincere character. And Joe and I worked really closely on Hanukkah. Like, we choreographed that whole last act of the movie together. And so I think that working really well together like that maybe tipped him off that maybe I could be a part of these movies.
Also showed you.
Oh, I want to say something in behalf of Sadie Katz. That was not her pussy you saw. That was CG. No, that was CG. They were CGI.
Sadie
said to me, that was not my snatch. She said, my snatch is not that tight. So I started to laugh my head off. Sadie has a great sense of humor. But that was not Sadie naked. They CGI'd that.
Also, though, going back to you, Robert, it showed, I think, between the two films, though, it showed that you really have acting chops because you didn't do the exact same thing, you know, in both films, which worked out really good. So let's go to Heather. Heather, like, Ron loved your performance.
Love her. I love her.
Thank you. I mean, this was just, like, the best thing ever. I mean, because Sarah and I had worked together previously on a horror thing where we became friends, and we ended up doing a lot of, like, press and parties for that. So me and my partner were able to hang out with her and Joe, and it was just like, wow, this is, like, a really fun, really wonderful. So I was able to come in already knowing them, which is so nice, because I also come mostly from television, so it was definitely a very different environment, just having this really like family friendly. And it's like, it's kind of obnoxious, but we really are like all kind of obsessed with each other. Like, we have a group text that we've had for like years now. Like, it really is this really, really warm, friendly, like we all love each other. Every time we see each other, we're like, oh my God, like we're so annoying. But I think it shows in the film, like it really is. It's people loving what they're doing, happy to be there, like really
absolutely
in their element, which
it does show.
The cast has to get along. There's an actress who I know of, I will not mention her name, who every time she's in a film eats up the scenery, the camera, and the director. She outplays everybody in the movie, and I just find that to be so unprofessional. You don't have to be noticed and loud and what's the word I'm looking for? When you're active, you're like a puppet. Whatever. when you're old, you forget everything. But anyway, that doesn't work in a movie. So if you're going into a film to say, I'm the best, I'm going to show those other assholes how to act, I'm going to be noticed. It's going to be my film. You know what? You'll look like a moron. The audience knows it. The director knows it. And guess where you're going? Down the toilet. It's teamwork. It's a gang. Look at Sarah French. Beautiful, smart, famous. She's not a snobby bitch. She's nice to everybody. She's a sweet girl. How could you not want to work with her and love her?
Exactly.
I mean, I would like to know the end of the movie.
Sarah,
better.
Did you just say exactly?
No, I wouldn't. Oh, it's true.
No, it's oh, okay.
True. No, some people.
You could, Sarah.
No, some people think Sarah is uppity and a bit of a snob. And I said, no, she's a girl with class. and she knows how to be a lady. And today people don't know that class and being a lady is not a snob, okay? You don't have to be vulgar, crude, and filthy to be in. Sarah French is an actress, a star. She's a movie person.
So let's go to Sarah Nicklin.
I love Sarah French, and I never did before. When I first met her, I thought she was a snobby bitch too, but she's really not. No, she's really not. She's the most warm.
In case you guys haven't figured out, Ron says whatever he thinks.
Well, that's why my show is number one. What do you think our show is? Number one 3 years in a row.
So let's go to Sarah.
We have over 5 million people watching right now.
Sarah, go to Sarah Nicklin.
Sarah Nicklin.
Hi, the other Sarah.
You dirty dog.
So, had you worked with other people? Had you worked with anybody else in the cast before, Sarah?
Yeah, I've worked with a couple people in this cast before in various different projects. I was actually in one of Devanny's films that she was producing like 7 years ago or something, The Black Dahlia Haunting.
So, yes.
It's definitely a very small indie horror film community out there. And similar to everyone else, just, you know, became friends with Marcel and Joe and Sarah, and then was invited to be part of this project. And it was just wonderful working with everyone and actually having a collaborative atmosphere where you have people that are willing to listen to your ideas, which, as we talked about, is not always something that happens on film set.
Okay, so now tell our audience, who did you play in Pretty Boy?
I play Jill, and Jill is a deaf character. And so that was something that was an idea that I brought to the set, since I had been learning sign language for about 2 years. And it was something that I wanted to be able to use in a film. And since Marcel had already created this, Marcel and Joe create this great world of exploring people with disabilities, I thought that this might be an appropriate place to use that in a film.
I
Very
loved
smart
it.
Move, because we need to have diversity. More than just ethnic diversity. We need to have diversity among people who are handicapped.
I think that you did a fabulous job. And you said it's a small indie community, but it's funny because the indie community is small, and we hang out in it a lot within the indie horror community. But you guys are actually like part of the indie community, but you're a part that we had not met before. So I love the fact that Marcel didn't go to the regular little group that we see at every event that we go to community. And he actually brought in a lot of new terrific actors, you know, for the film, because I think it'll bring such a broader audience. So let's go to Joe Castro.
I feel like I'm the grandfather of all of you, and that I love you all like little children, because I watch you work. I used to watch movie stars work, the greatest legends of Hollywood. I used to watch them work, and they were stars already. And it's fun to watch all you young people becoming what you will be one day when you have all of it under your belt. And I love doing it. See, I can be serious and normal when I choose to, but I don't choose to be because I talk too much and I'm quite boring.
So go ahead, Joe Castro. Joe Castro. So Joe, like, this is a little bit different because you didn't have to really create a monster so much as you had to do like decapitations and stuff. So how was that for you, and how was it working with this fabulous group of people?
Well, first of all, it was, kind of a dream come true to work on this project, because I have such a deep respect for the first film, Blind. And I think most people know this. What Marcel created with the first film on the limited budget is something that I truly Amazing. Respect deeply. You know, he created a studio quality looking film on a micro budget, which is what we all strive to do. And then also, I like the ending of the first film. It's like that unconventional ending that made me want more. You know, I wanted a sequel to it.
Yeah, we
so,
did.
And here we are. And so it was kind of a gift to be able to be a part of this amazing team. But I want to say most of y'all don't know this. Y'all are all talking about acting, but I just started my acting career, so I'm hoping maybe Marcel might put me in the third one. Hint, hint.
Never beg for a part. Never beg for a part.
And then when I first was approached by Marcel and Joe and Sarah, and we sat down and talked about doing the gore and the special effects with this, I basically said, whatever you can imagine, that's what I want to do. I, you know, And I kind of was like, can we even go further? Can we make it even more gory? Can we do this? And Marcel was like, yes, whatever you think will work best, Joey. And he kind of delegated the authority to me to come up with some new and interesting deaths.
Joe, gory is good, but gory should not be the movie. Because if it's only gore without anything else, to me, it's junk. It's not a movie. It's some stupid asshole that didn't know what he was doing and hired you to put in a bunch of head, arms, and blood and eyeballs. Whereas Marcel directed a film written by Joe with a story, with lines, with good acting by Sarah and the rest of the cast. And that was what made it a successful film. Just to have heads rolling in blood all over, to me, is good if you're mentally ill, and that's what you and that's what you need to make you happy. If you become happy by seeing people's pieces being chopped up, you need help. Turn away. No, Jimmy will tell you. I'm in horror movies, but I turn away. When I see your stuff, Joe, I turn away. I can't look at it.
But the gore in this film, isn't really just gore. It is not gory.
It's not.
It's effective, and that's where Marcel used me to the best of.
That's the difference.
It was effective.
Effective, not gory. I like
effective.
That.
You know,
I have to say that there was one. I don't want to. There's one kill in the movie that was. It sounds weird saying that, but that was my dream kill for years, and I was looking for a movie. That has to be in something. So, and Joe Netter wrote that perfectly for that character in there. It was perfect. And I won't say who it is, but someone's getting a knife in his mouth.
Oh, stop with that one.
That was awesome. I loved it. I thought that was awesome.
I hated that. I didn't know it was coming. And when it came, I almost fainted. I hated it.
I loved it. I thought it was awesome.
It scares the shit out of you. Are you
and
kidding?
That's also a thing. You don't see a lot, but there's no blood spraying everywhere. And that's, I think that was the good thing what Joe Castro did. It's effective.
It was amazing what he did.
It was
so realistic.
Nobody was, wait, what? What happened? And that acting from that person was so perfectly done because she couldn't believe what had happened, and it was great. That is one of my favorite parts in the movie, and Joe Castro did an amazing job with that.
Yay, Joe!
You did a good job, Joe, because you really made me sick. And I turned away. I wouldn't even watch it. I couldn't watch it.
I want to give props, too, real quick. I mean, everybody in the cast was awesome, but I also want to give props and shout-outs to Maria Olson. She's been on our show a couple of times. She was really, really – I mean, she is such a stellar actress. Robert Rustler, we want to give him a big, big props, too. Yeah. Everybody else that was in the cast, but they were two names that you added also to the cast that everybody kind of knows. And they brought a lot to the table, but especially Maria Olson. We don't want to tell everybody what she is, but you guys, when you see it, she's really freaking good.
And I want to give Sarah French a plug. There's a movie that you should see. The movie's not great, but Sarah French is great. It's, what was it called, honey, the movie we were in together where I played Minister? What was that called?
Oh, Clown Fear.
Clown Fear. It used to be, wasn't it Clown Road, Circus Road? And then it became Clown Fear. Anyway, if you want to see Sarah French in a lake, kind of almost naked, Dave, you horny guy, or all of the rest of you horny little masturbators out there, watch Sarah French. She'll make you burn in a minute.
So let's go to Sarah French now. So Sarah,
I love you, Sarah French.
Sarah,
I really do.
This is a very, I mean, for you, this is.
No, you look like Kim Novak. And you act better than she did.
I don't know if you guys know who Kim Novak is.
Oh, they'll look it up.
But look it up, you guys. She's a huge star.
Kim Novak was a great beauty. Jimmy Stewart, the movie was Vertigo. Kim Novak. Look it up.
So let's go to Sarah.
And
so
she and Kim Novak was from Minnesota also.
So this must be kind of like a cool thing for you because, you know, you get to write with your partner. You're in a movie written by your partner. You're in the star of a sequel. The first one was a huge hit. This one's going to be a huge hit. How has this whole like experience been for you, and how was it working with a new cast in this film? Because the cast is different.
And you didn't have to sleep with Marcel Walz.
Well, that's a win for her then.
It's a win for you too, because you wouldn't like it.
Probably not. No, it was was really an amazing experience, especially reprising my role as Faye in the sequel. I've never been able to do that before. And I remember my very first day on set, Kwame was doing my makeup and he was getting me into the character because it's a direct sequel from Blind. So it takes place literally minutes after. So we had to do the complete same look again. And it was very an emotional experience because Blind was so special to me and so close to me that being able to reprise this was a big deal. And so Kwame's doing my makeup. I get into costume, I start walking to set, and Marcel and Joe and Jed are in the set in the room. And I walk in and I basically just start crying. It was just a very emotional experience. And
let me say that wasn't the first time and the last time.
But you know what, Sarah, that's good, Sarah, because it boosted up your it boosted up your energy for the scene that you had to do. Just the scene that you did, I don't want to give it away, looks easy. Everybody's going to say, oh, what's Ron Russell bullshitting about? I could do that. You can't do that. You think you can do that, but you can't, because it has to be done with technique. If you overdo it, it's boring. If you underdo it, it's boring-er. She did it exactly right. I notice everything in film. I look at camera, lighting, directing, right, Jimmy? I mean, I'm in the business 100 years. I know all about film business.
Actually, these people don't know you, so you should tell them. So you guys, he's 81.
I'm 81.
So you know.
I've been in movies for 64 years. You know, since 19 years old with Sophia Loren and Tab Hunter, my first movie. Directed by Sidney Lumet. That's why I said Marcel has got that technique. Years ago, directors, they were there, but they weren't there, but they made you know they were there. It was a magical thing they did. I can't even explain it. Some directors today, like this movie I was in with Sarah, the director was in another room the whole movie. And I said, doesn't he direct us? And he came out once in a while and said, oh, don't do that. Don't do this. And he went back in the room. And I thought, fuck movies today. I hate doing this shit. And then the other movie I was on, that director was like an egotistical maniac who thought he was more than he was. Anyway, Marcel, I mean this with all my heart. I'm so happy that I'm going to be in your film called The Bride, The Wedding. What is it called?
Yeah, Bride.
Am I still in that, or did you fire me because I comment about your tits all the time?
You're fine. You're
really want to work. I really want to work with you, because I think that you and I together will really do a great performance. I mean that. I'm a good actor, by the way.
Oh yeah.
I just don't remember lines, but now that I have the plug in my ear, I remember everything. And when the other actors fuck up, I look at them and say, "Don't you know your lines?" Getting even is such fun.
So I want to find out. So we have all because since several of you we don't really know. Are you guys fans? We'll go around the thing. Are you guys fans of the horror genre in general? Do you do a lot of horror films, or is it like you do horror films but you don't really like to watch them? Like I love to watch them. Ron doesn't, but I love to watch them. So let's go, Robert. You first.
No, let me say something. I would love to see Sarah French one day in a lifetime love movie. I would love to see her with the handsome guy falling in love, running off to Paris or some shit like that. I mean, Sarah, we got to get you out of, well, stay in horror movies, but we've got to somehow, Jimmy and I, get you into other movies, because I think that you would be wonderful as a love interest in a lovely romance movie that I would really enjoy.
Plus, seeing. I saw you kicking ass on video, like how you're learning how to be an action hero. So then we could maybe you could be like the next like.
Well, what's that?
Salt.
What's that all about? tell us why you're rehearsing that.
Well, it's for a space adventure film. We haven't announced anything or talked about anything yet, but that's the next film I'm working.
There you go. She's going to be an action star. All right, let's go back around. Robert, do you like horror movies? Do you watch them, or are you just in them but you don't really like them?
No, I love horror movies. I just was always in comedy and never knew how to get into that world. I used to watch all the Leprechaun movies.
Yes, I like the Leprechaun movies.
Leprechaun, all the Halloween movies, Child's Play, like Monkey Shines, all that whole like era of VHS.
I love that.
You see, you kids grew up in that. So therefore, yeah. That's your movie. In my day, we had Bela Lugosi, Boris Karloff, those were our horror people. And they were no big deal. There was no heads rolling, no blood, nothing. You know, Frankenstein, da, 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 and Bella, da, da, da. that was like big deal. So I'm not a horror freak because I didn't grow up with them. But understandably so, all you kids did.
You should see my office is filled with horror movie memorabilia.
His birthday cake. I have the dining room table with every monster in the world around it. And there's Jimmy sitting there with his glow in his face like he was around his family.
So let's go to Heather. Heather, do you like horror movies? Do you watch horror movies? You said you came from TV, so it might be a little different. Do you like the horror TV? Tell us a little bit.
Oh my God. Yeah. I mean, the level of like Castle Rock and American Horror Story that like horror is going in television is like my dream. But I mostly do drama on television, but yeah, no, I love horror. I got into it later but I really like, psychological stuff like Hereditary, like stuff or like Midsommar, like that you're just like, oh God, like I love that kind of stuff, which is why I love this project. Because I think it's kind of in the same vein.
I thought Midsommar was like super fucking jacked up though. Like nobody's gonna jump off a fucking cliff to their death. I was like, this is fucking nuts. Oh, look at Joe Castro. Yeah. He's like, yeah.
See, I told you he's bent out of shape.
So go to Sarah. Sarah, do you like horror movies? Do you watch horror movies? Are you in a lot of horror movies? I don't know that much about you. Tell us a little bit.
Oh, me, Sarah. Okay, me, Sarah.
Oh yeah. Yes. Oh yeah. Sarah Nicklin. I'm sorry. Sarah N.
Yeah. Horror is great. I work mostly in horror. I've done like 90 something horror movies at this point. And it's a very loyal genre. So people keep, once you start working in it, you know, it's just a ball that keeps rolling and rolling and rolling. But mostly I love watching horror too. That's pretty much almost exclusively all I watch.
So what's your favorite horror movie? Like what's one of your favorite horror movies? And you can't say Pretty Boy because that doesn't count.
You got to give me like a subgenre within horror because there's way too many different things.
I like torture porn.
Let's get back. Let's
not a big fan of torture porn.
Let's get back to the business because that interests so many of our viewers. Marcel, question for you. A budget. Let's say you have a $100,000 budget to make a movie. And you hire an actor, a famous actor, for $200 a day, and he normally works for $2,000 a day. What do you expect from that actor?
Well, at that point, probably a lot of love for the project, because if that's she normally gets $2,000 and then working for $200 because she wants to be in that movie probably so badly. So I'm happy.
My answer is. My answer to that is a good actor always acts good no matter what he's paid. Okay? That's what you have to look for in an actor, because there are a lot of actors out there who are demanding a lot of money for a better performance. And if I hear them say to a producer, well, I'll give you a better performance if you give me my salary, you know what I say to them? There's a door, open it and get the fuck out of here. Because that's not an actor. An actor acts because he loves the work and he acts because he wants to be great.
I agree 100%. And that's actually the best example is for some of the, let's say, action stars from the 90s. They doing now all those new action movies, whatever, and they got hired for 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, whatever, and they're only on set reading the lines, and that's something that's sad.
I get so upset when I see that.
Yeah.
The come on star.
Especially when there's such big names in the.
Yeah, the come on star.
Yeah.
They have a crappy movie. They hire Burt Reynolds. Oh, not Burt, he's dead. They hire Sophia Loren just for her name. And then she's in it for 1 minute, reading one line. And I think that's so underhanded, dirty pool, and lousy theater. It shouldn't be.
Go back to Kwame. Kwame, because you do makeup on a lot of different kinds of projects. Are you a big fan of horror?
When I was younger, I was the biggest scaredy cat. I used to think the alien lived in my laundry room. I grew to love horror, and now I'm catching up. Like, I just watched I Knew What You Did Last Summer for the first time.
Oh my God, I love it.
I love learning the gags and all that, because it taught me not to be scared. and then I could do my laundry.
There you go. I like love it. Sarah, I'm going to assume you love them because Joe writes a lot of them and that you're in like so many of them. So I'm going to Sarah
oh,
French
she's
now
in
we're
them
talking
only
to.
Because she's getting her feet wet. Sarah French, and I'm going to predict this on the air, and I don't say things unless I feel they're right. About 5 years from now, you will be paying money to see Sarah French on the big screen in feature films. I firmly believe that. And when it happens, Sarah, you got to give me a big kiss.
Oh, you know I will, Ron.
She can be the next Angelina Jolie.
Yeah, I mean, those broads that are out there now. And I mean, Charlize Theron, okay, I'd say, yeah, she's something else. But the rest of those tomatoes, they're just regular broads off the street. Shitty actresses, not even great. I mean, you could go up there. You could clean up on in Hollywood. You just got to get one good movie, Sarah, one big major role, and you're flying like forget about it. You got it. You know, I met years ago in the fabric store many, 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 many years ago, Broadway's Bernadette Peters, whose name was Bernadette Lazzara from the Lazzara Italian Bread Company in my neighborhood. And I said to Bernadette, I said, you know, Bernadette, you really have a beautiful voice, and I predict that one day you're going to be a super Broadway star. And she did. And I ran into her at a restaurant in New York, and she came over to me. She said, oh, by the way, here's that kiss I owe you. And she kissed me. She said, it happened. I said, I know, Bernie. You're fabulous. So I have an eye for what's good and what's not. And you're good. You're going places, sister. Just don't lose your head. Stay, put your feet planted on the ground. Stay who you are. Be who you are. You're great. You're so beautiful and so sweet. I love you. Thank I really you. Do. No, I mean, I don't say that to too many people. I do a lot of Hollywood I love you bullshits. You know, we do. I love you. I love you. But really don't give a fuck. But but there are times that you do meet people. I love my Sadie Katz. I love you. I love also that Sherry Davis. I love when she kicks the shit out of people on the screen. I love it. She is such a tough hombre. But yeah, there's a lot. And I love Marcel also. He's a sweetie pie.
And he loves all you guys too. It just doesn't know you that well.
I don't know you all. I don't know. I'm not going to say I like all of you. I like your work, but I don't love you because I don't know you. But I know Marcel. I've slept with him so many times. My God. I mean, you know.
So how many?
Not really. That was a joke, Dom. Dom, that was only kidding.
So wait, let's go. I want to find out a little bit. So Sarah Nicklin. So you said you've been in 90 like horror movies. What are some of the bigger ones that like maybe we like our audience might know what they are?
So I just had a movie that premiered actually last week called Retaliators.
I've heard of
movie.
That.
So that
I
should
actually
be coming
heard of that one.
To streaming services soon.
Marcel says it's good. If Marcel says it's good, it's
is
good.
That like the movie Alligator that we saw with the flood
game? No, not Alligator.
Oh, did she say Alligator?
No. What's tell me the title again.
Retaliator.
Oh, I thought I heard Alligator.
Retaliator, yeah.
Alligator. I heard. Remember that movie Alligator, where the flood came and the alligator was in the basement, and the girl couldn't get out of the basement, and the alligator was after her. That was a fabulous.
I like that
movie.
It was fun.
I think all you guys. I think though, all you female actresses are like super, like making great films. I mean, I've always considered Danielle Harris basically to be like the top of the Scream Queen ladder or whatever, because you know she's been in such huge movies and. And she's been acting since she was like
Caroline
7.
Caroline Williams was.
No, Danielle Harris is huge. And,
whatever happened to Caroline Williams? Is she still making movies?
I think so, yes.
Is Caroline in anything? I haven't seen her in years.
She's in Blind.
I guess not.
She's in Blind, you guys. If you could, you
oh,
can
right.
see Caroline in Blind.
I forgot
and Hanukkah.
And Hanukkah. That's right. She's in Blind.
And,
well, Hanukkah.
And
Blood Feast. Was she in Blood Feast?
Yeah.
Oh, there she goes. So she was in some, and now you're just working with new actresses. So I think that, but I think that Danielle Harris is kind of like at the epitome of the horror genre. I don't know if she works all as much as she used to work anymore. I think you guys are the up and comers that are like taking over. You know, we'll be taking over the genre. Well, Marcel, you're in a totally different class. I would say that we probably go to. Let's say we go to 20 red carpet like movie premieres at least a year, and basically besides the Mahal brothers, some of their films have been pretty good, I thought. But besides theirs, nobody comes close to the.
Well,
films
I
got to
tell you a little story, Marcel. I would never tell on the air. But I don't give a shit. I was at a movie red carpet, and a person, a filmmaker, a filmmaker came over to me and he said to me, Ron, how come you don't say nice things about my film the way you talk about Blind? And I said, because your film stinks. Well, what was I going to say? You have the nerve to come up and put me in a position like that? You deserve the answer. You asked, why don't you? Well, I told you, because your film stinks. If your film was as good as Blind, I'd be blowing it out my ass too. But, you know.
So it must be like fun. So hey, let's go back to Heather. So Heather, you said you usually do drama. Like, what might have we seen you in as a drama on television?
I mean, I do a lot of, you know, I've done like NCIS and Criminal Minds, and I was on Wicked City. I just finished a film for Disney Plus that'll come out next year. I was just on Truth Be Told on Apple TV Plus. So I do a lot of like 1 hour drama, and then
so you're on your way. You're on your way now. You're on your way.
I hope so. I'm tired.
Well, you know, you got the stepping stones to get up there. It's hard to get out of horror because everybody has a low opinion of horror actors. My dearest friends in the world happen to be many, many soap opera stars. And of course, Sean Kanan is my son. He's my very best dear friend. And they are so disrespected in the movie film business. You know, I suggested Sean Kanan. They said, oh, what, a soap opera star? Hey, you know, they're actors. They're not soap opera stars.
It's way harder to do a soap.
And all the kids in these horror movies, they're not horror stars. They're actors. They can do anything. You know, stop putting people in little boxes with labels, for Christ's sake. Yeah. Actors are actors. And let them be. Let them show you what they can do. Cut the shit out there, everybody. Stupid people with narrow minds.
So wait, let's go to Rob. So Robert, you're a comedian, meaning do you do stand-up comedy or you're in comedy shows? What is it that you do before you were doing horror?
I was part of a sketch comedy, like pretty big YouTube channel for a while, and then got hired on a bunch of True TV shows, like when they started their narrative thing. And now I'm developing a pilot, a sketch show pilot now that I'm in the cast for. So it's that sort of was always happening. And then, you know, I did like a post 9/11 Guantanamo Bay drama a month ago and, you know, a couple commercials. And I kind of dipped my toe in all those.
I like love areas. It. You guys should, like, you know, get an agent to put when Pretty Boy is out to the public and then go and do autograph signings as a cast places, you know, and, like, get the whole cast because it's a lot of fun to go to the horror conventions and you get to meet people who really – well, you know, when you meet those people, they will support you in every single thing. I always use Lance Henriksen as an example because he's one of my favorite actors, and I've met him a zillion times. He's been on the show. But, like, I watch everything that he does, and, like, even, like, sometimes he does some real shitaroos, and he does a lot of movies where they just pay him, you know, to, like, use his name, and he's in them for 4 seconds, you know, and he's not. But I watch all of them anyway because I'm a big fan, and I think that if you identify with the fans, you'll do it.
You're making us go to sleep.
No, we're not.
Yes, you are. That's such a fucking boring bullshit you do every day. Come on, talk fun or something.
That is fun.
You know, you go on, you're monotonous. You go on and on.
Well, Marcel and I are going to the Twin Cities Film Festival this weekend.
Yeah, yes. There you go.
No, yes. Blind is...
Wait, they're going to the film festival. You didn't miss it.
I heard. I can hear and talk at the same time. Yeah. I'm not senile yet. Blind is a film that is going to be more famous 4 years, 5 years from now than it is now. It's like The Night of the Living Dead, $65,000 movie about zombies way back in 1960, what, 847? Nobody cared for it, didn't make it in the movies, went to the drive-ins, didn't do well. It was a stinkeroo. Well, today it's the number one zombie movie ever made, The Night of the Living Dead, the original black and white. And I believe that Blind is going to snowball. As it is shown and as it goes out there, I think it's going to become greater and greater and greater with time. Because a lot of the audiences today, and don't get offended, audiences, but you're stupid, you want to see heads rolling, blood flying all over. If there's this film that you have to use your brain to think about, you get exhausted and you don't enjoy it. That's why you have to educate yourself to seeing a movie with a plot, a story, a beginning, a middle, and an end. That's what I said. Now I have just lost about 5 million views.
No, you didn't, because they all know that you just say shit. Everybody like loves horror. Like, there wouldn't be the number one genre and the one that everybody makes if there weren't a lot of fans.
I know that, but Blind is not a horror movie.
It's more of a thriller.
It's a thriller.
It's a thriller horror.
That's why I'm happy to say it has guts and shit.
It has a beginning, a middle, and an end.
Yeah, but it's a thriller.
It's a story. It's a love story, Ron.
Yeah. It's a dark love story. It's a weird love story. It's a scary love. It's a love story nobody wants to be in. That's for sure.
So hang on. Go back to Marcel. So Marcel, I noticed there's all kinds of things. So Pretty Boy has a costume, and I noticed you guys did like VHS tapes and all kinds of stuff. Can people get that stuff yet or no?
Oh, yeah. There's a Pretty Boy costume from Trick or Treat Studios, and we got very lucky with that because that's one of the best companies for Halloween or for costumes, masks, and stuff like that. They have Michael Myers. They have everything. They have fucking everything. So that's great. So that's out since a year. The costume, the mask, the wig, everything. VHS came out, I think, a month ago from
Retro Media. Okay.
Yes. So, yep. And then also a soundtrack on vinyl, which is great. Which I just got it. It's a pink vinyl, and it's fun. That was with all the music from Mirko Hirsch from Pretty Boy. So yeah, we got lucky with all the merchandise. We have.
And you have to make. You need like a 12-inch action figure of Pretty Boy.
Well, there's something coming.
There you go. Oh, there we go. Look at Sarah. Sarah's got it, baby.
Sorry.
And also, Marcel failed to mention that the music in A Blind and Pretty Boy was composed for the movies. It was not.
Yeah.
Bought music. They didn't buy over-air music. Tell us, who composed the music for both films?
So, the soundtrack with all the songs is from Mirko Hirsch. He did all this. He did some of the songs for the first one and all the songs for the second one. And they're just perfect because we have that 80s vibe through the whole film, and the music is just perfect. Perfect. And,
so you see,
and the single is Love is Blind, everybody. You guys... Yeah. The single is freaking awesome.
You see, it's like baking a cake. If you put all the right ingredients in, you have a delicious cake. And what Marcel has done is he's put all the right ingredients into his movie, and that's why he's got a splendid movie. Marcel, you're wonderful. What more can I say? But let's go out tomorrow night and hug and kiss a lot, maybe tongue kiss a little, you know. I'll grow.
So here's what I want to do. I want to go around. I don't know where our next guest is, so I'm going to keep you guys on in case our next guest isn't here.
But the next guest must have heard my language and said, oh, that's not for me. I'm sophisticated.
So here's what I want to do. Like a bucket list for everybody. We'll go one by one. If you could have been any actor and actress that you have on a bucket list that you would love to work with, and if you could have been in any movie ever made in Hollywood, Marcel, for you, maybe ever directed any movie made in Hollywood. Who would it be? So I need a male actor, a female actor, and a movie that you would think that you would have loved to have been in. Sarah French, you go first since you're the star.
Well, actor-wise, who I'd love to work with is Kurt Russell.
There you go. He lives down the street from us.
Yeah, he lives right down the road.
He and his wife. I'm coming over.
No, he and his wife. What's his wife?
Goldie Hawn.
Goldie Hawn. They live not even three blocks from here.
Okay, go ahead. Next, male. Male actor. Oh, that's Kurt Russell. Female actor.
I love Sigourney Weaver.
Oh, she's
I awesome. Do too. I do also.
Love her.
And if you could have been in any movie that's ever been around and made before, what movie would you have liked to have been in?
I've said this before and many times. I love the movie Legend.
Oh, Tom Cruise?
I love Legend, dude. That's such a throwback.
It's a beautiful love story. Everything about that
I
film.
Love that film.
It's not
I
a
like,
horror
love
film,
it.
But beautiful fantasy.
No, it's not a
horror.
It doesn't have to be a horror film anyway. Marcel, your turn. Go. Male actor, okay. Female actor in a movie you would have liked to have directed.
Oh, this should be perverted.
No, so female is definitely Cher.
Oh, there
Cher?
We go.
She might be in my movie.
Well, then pick up the director and I will do that. So,
we already hired Michelle Kanan.
But you can come to the
but
set.
You can come to the set and meet her if she plays the part.
I will be there.
Okay, go ahead.
So, okay. Yeah, definitely her. That's my biggest dream.
You know,
I've
met Cher. And she was very slow motion, sleepy-eyed, smiled a lot, spoke very little and then went to sleep on the, in the green room on one of the sofas.
Look at Kwame's like, let me set this up. Okay, wait, wait. What movie? What movie, Marcel?
I mean, definitely. The biggest dream or the goal for me was to direct an episode for American Horror Story. That's everything.
They were good.
But movie-wise, I would say probably...
Come on. We can't have dead air.
Texas Chainsaw.
Okay.
I mean, no, the biggest dream would be something to like Scream, but that's, well, that's hard to get probably.
I want
to
say something because you got to ask me that. I'm in a movie with Sarah French. As soon as we're funded, Sarah plays my daughter.
She probably doesn't even know that.
She don't even know that. Dave Bailey's film.
That's not the movie that you're dying to make, though. That's not like going to be in any movie ever. That wouldn't be that.
No. I'm shooting Red River soon in Nevada. What's her name?
Ming. No, let's go around. I want to get around because
I have to finish
comes.
Now. Ming
Ballard.
Ballard's film.
Okay, hold on.
No, Sarah, did Dave send you the script?
No. Okay. So.
Because you, it's a very good script, by the way. It's a wonderful script.
Okay, hold on. Okay. You'll find out about it eventually when we get the funding. Go to Kwame. Kwame, so you're not an actor. So what actress and actor would you like to do makeup on? And then what movie would you have liked to do makeup on? We'll change it and make it fit for your category.
It's funny because I just wrote it down like a day ago. I want to work on Emma Thompson.
Oh, I love her.
Emma Thompson.
She's fabulous.
Her eyes look like they're going to fall out of her head.
That's where I step in. Jim Carrey.
Jim Carrey's a good one. Okay, and what movie would you have liked to have been on?
It's not a horror movie, but it's Lemony Snicket. Series of Unfortunate Events.
Great movie.
It's just so much makeup.
All right. So let's go to the Sarah N.
Yes. Let's see. Female, I would say Jessica Lange. I love her.
Oh, yay!
Oh, she's so good.
I love it. She's wonderful.
Yeah. She's absolutely fantastic. And then for male, Gary Oldman. I love him too. Yeah.
Oh, he's great.
And then I would have loved to have had Natalie Portman's role in Black Swan. That would have loved that film. It's such a good role.
Marcel would have loved that role too.
As a ballerina. All right, Heather, you're up.
Oh, man. I mean, for a male actor, I would love to work with Shia LaBeouf. I think he's extraordinarily talented. And he would give me like a real run for my money.
You don't know him.
Who is it?
He's so great.
Boy or girl?
Boy.
Have I ever seen his work?
Transformers. I don't know. Like, I love the movie where he gets under house arrest.
I don't know who he is.
The guy's killing people next door. He's fabulous. And Holes was a great kids movie. All right. Okay. Give us a female.
And then for the same reasons, I would love to work with Sarah Paulson because I feel like she would also really give me a run for my money. Like, that would force me. They would both force me to really rise to the occasion, which I would enjoy a lot.
I love that. Then what would you?
So all of your people are young. You know, you don't have any older people up to.
Hang on. Let her finish.
I mean, Sarah's in her 40s. Yeah. Is that not middle age?
Sarah Paulson's in her 40s. She said.
That's like young. Are you shitting?
So wait. Tell us a movie. What movie would you have liked to have been in?
I would have really loved to have done Lisbeth in the American David Fincher Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. I think that would have been.
Wow, that's a great pick. That freaking shit was awesome. Which I didn't like the American version, but the European version was awesome.
I almost exclusively only watch foreign film and television, but for whatever reason, I preferred the American version of that series.
Did you really?
Yeah, because I love Fincher.
That's true. Okay, so let's go, Robert. Male actor, female actor, and what movie would you have liked to have been in?
My goal in life is to remake The Burbs. So I would say The Burbs.
Oh, don't you dare touch it.
Great movie.
I don't care if you like it.
No one should touch a classic.
So wait.
They stink when they do the
Okay, so
the
we need a male and
I'll
a
do whatever
actor.
I want, but Gene Wilder and Madeline Kahn.
I knew Madeline Kahn. She smoked pot like cigarettes. She was always loaded. I loved her.
You would have got along.
No, she was she was the kindest, most sincere, wonderful, sweet, delicious human being.
Why did you say
she lived around the corner from me in Manhattan? I met her in the street, like a street pickup. And we went for coffee together, and we became friendly, and we used to go to each other's apartments. Loved Madeline Kahn. When she died, I was devastated.
So, Robert, did you say you would have gotten along or wouldn't have gotten along?
No, we would have got along just
fine. Oh, yeah. You would have Are you Jewish?
No, I'm Italian.
Oh, because she was Jewish. Italian. She was Jewish, and she liked she liked Jewish people. She had most of our friends were Jewish.
So well, I usually don't correct people when they assume I'm Jewish.
No, but Madeline Kahn would. Madeline, and she was a brilliant, brilliant comedian.
But you said she liked to smoke pot, and he said, we would have gotten on.
We were walking on 3rd Avenue around the corner going to the bakery, and she lit up a joint. And I said, Madeline, you're not, in those days it was against the law. I said, Madeline, you're not allowed to smoke a joint in the street. She said, well, keep saying it so they'll know it's a joint. Nobody knows it's a joint. And then she inhaled it and went in the store, and she ordered her bagels, and the smoke came out. And the lady said, somebody in here smells like they shouldn't be in here. And she said to me, oh, fuck her.
So, Joe Castro,
Madeline
you're
Kahn was wonderful.
Joe Castro, male actor, female actor in a movie you'd like to be in or have done the special effects for. It could be either one.
Okay, those are all great questions. For a male actor, I would love to have worked with and directed Christopher Lee. I know he's dead, but I would love to work with him.
I knew Christopher Lee. I knew him.
He's just such a reverend.
We had an argument because we were at Shelby Goodman's house in Beverly Hills at a party. And I said, Chris, I love all your Dracula movies. Well, he looked at me and said, Ron, I have done more than Dracula. I have done some fabulous films in my day. I said, I don't blow a tit. I said, I just simply said, I loved you as Dracula. He said, and you continue to say that, don't you? So I looked at him, I said, what are you on? And I hope you're on something, because if you're not, you're a nasty fuck. And I walked away. I'm swear to God, it's a true story. And his wife came over,
Marcel and Sarah know that he's telling the truth. And
wait a minute. His wife had a cape on down to the floor.
I believe everything works.
No, wait. His wife had a cape on down to the floor. Not a black one, a jeweled cape. And she came rushing over to me. I thought, here comes the vampire lady. And she said to me, I'm so sorry. She said, Christopher's very sensitive about that. And Ron, he does like you. He didn't mean to be rude. I said, I really don't give a shit. I said, I'm used to actors. They're all nuts. And I chalked it off.
So wait, go. Joe, female.
Jamie Lee Curtis. I would love to direct her and in a brand new slasher movie and work with her. I would love to work with Jamie Lee Curtis. It would be a total dream come true.
I was friends with her dad.
I
met her, and she's an amazing woman and so inspiring to be around and be in her presence, and it would just be a real honor.
Well, Tony Curtis, her dad, was my good friend, and he said that Janet Lee turned his children against him. So they never really had a good relationship, she and her dad, which was sad, because when Tony died, I believe that she was upset that he didn't leave her any money. And Tony had a reason why he didn't leave any of his children.
Tony Curtis was actually supposed to star in the first feature film I directed back in 1993. And
he was a sweetheart of a guy, a gem. I love Tony. My daughter Leslie loved him also.
Vincent Price was also supposed to be in it, but his
I knew Vinny. I knew Vinny.
His manager said, "No, don't be in this kid's movie. Let Edward Scissorhands be your last film," because they didn't know he was sick at the time. But and we actually wrote the role for him to be in a bed, and he was going to be in my directorial debut. But
I was in a movie.
In a movie with Vincent Price, where we all ran down Hollywood Boulevard at daybreak because we were all vampires. And Vincent was the lead vampire. And you would have loved it, Joe. One by one, we exploded, we melted, whatever the fuck they did to us. We were all croaking on the road. Anyway, in between takes, I sat on the curb with Vinnie Price. And we chatted. He was a sweetheart of a guy and quite a funny fella.
Yeah.
He was a gay guy that hit it. But he knew that
him being in my film would totally make my career, and somehow, and he was a really sweet man, and he wanted to do it, but his manager wouldn't let him do it.
And I kind of feel like
every step of the way, I mean, up to now, where my career has really started to take off, there's always been somebody there, kind of knocking me down a peg, keeping me holding
that
me back.
That always happens.
Yeah, well, you know.
It's called growing pains. But Joe, you're gonna do it. You're gonna be up there very soon, number one, two, Universal top star. I knew what's his name at Universal, the makeup artist there, the famous one. What the hell was his name?
Baker.
Baker was a buddy of mine years when I was at Universal. I made a Sarah with Brenda Vaccaro, a TV series, and so he was a good guy. He had some shit there in his studio. Joe, you would have loved it. Oh, he had parts that moved, like ugly hands that really walked in skeevy looking things.
So, Marcel, I have a question. First of all, Roxy.
He didn't let me tell you what film I wanted to be in.
What film you want to be in?
Anything Godzilla. The Godzilla franchise is the most successful franchise in motion picture history, even above Star Wars.
Because
they've made 42 films, and those films have been translated to every country all over the world.
I have a Godzilla.
Yeah, but you're gonna have to do Asian eye makeup. Otherwise, you can't be in Godzilla.
I love Godzilla. I got for like 5 years ago for my birthday, Ron got me a Godzilla. It's about 4 feet long with the tail.
They have every kind of thing in a Godzilla movie. They have special effects. They have acting. They got sets. They got stop motion. They got CGI.
Yeah, they don't have any stories.
Makeup. And that. Well, the story. Godzilla versus the Smog Monster, which is the darkest film of the entire series, is a beautiful tale. And if it's a social commentary about pollution, but it's a great movie, and you've never seen it. It's like the best Godzilla film ever made.
Did you like Godzilla versus Kong?
It was good.
It was just okay, not great.
It doesn't have that. I mean, like you literally at one point in this other film I'm talking about, you almost cry for Godzilla because you care about him so much. He's a good guy. Godzilla, it has a soul, you know.
And all right, I'm going back to Marcel. So Marcel. So I have two things, and we can play one of them. Roxy, you can keep everybody on, right? And we can play something and then bring them back, I hope. So I've got a Pretty Boy clip, the clip I think that Fangoria had, and I also have the Murka Hearst Love is Blind music video. Which one would you like to play?
Pretty Boy clip. I want to see it.
Yeah.
All right. So, Roxy, hopefully you can do that and you don't lose everybody. We might have time to do them both since our guest.
I want to do them both.
So here's the Pretty Boy clip. You introduce it, Marcel, and then Roxy, hopefully I don't hear from you, but hopefully you can. Oh, yeah, she said yes. Okay, you can play it. So the Pretty Boy clip.
Pretty Boy.
All right, you introduce it for us, Marcel.
So yeah, I think that's a clip with Devanny, and that was our exclusive clip for Fangoria with Devanny Pinn and Roba and Pretty Boy.
Mm-hmm.
for it. Hey, so Marcel, I don't think that was the Fangoria one. I think
that one was
Sarah French and Maria Olson and Pretty Boy.
That was like a nightmare that you're having. And then when that spike came in, I went, oh, I got scared. You scared me, you stupid fucks. But anyway.
He seen it. He knew what was going to happen.
No, the spike. You know the spike when it went bing?
Yeah.
That jolted me. No, you're... Everybody out there, please, please watch these films. You're going to be so happy that I told you to watch them. You're going to say, you know, Ron Russell knows his stuff. He's no dummy, even though sometimes I act like one.
So but let's. Anyway. I want to go back now to Marcel.
But wait, before we sign off, I want to say but I want to say something because I'm old. I forget. Sarah, Marcel, I'm inviting you and yours to our house sometime in December when we're entertaining again. For a dinner party. Sue Wong will be there. A lot of actors and actresses that are older that you could meet. It'll be a fun evening. So I'll give you the dates as soon as we know them.
Thank you. And you can invite Cher if you want, just on a side note.
Cher, I'll tell you something. If Cher
commits.
No, if. Yeah, well, Kurt, you can. I'll go. You, Sarah, no bullshit. You and I will go down and ring the bell. You never know. He may answer. You never know. Of course, they have a gate. You know, it's a big gated house. But he may answer and come to the gate.
People see him here all the time at like Home Depot and all over the place.
I was just in Borders bookstore a couple of months ago, and he and Goldie were in there. They just came.
Borders. Barnes & Noble.
Barnes & Noble. Borders.
Borders is out of business.
I'm still a New Yorker. But anyway, Barnes & Noble, and Goldie and he had just come down from the mountains, you know, where they have a place up in Aspen.
All right, so Marcel, I want to talk real quick about how did you meet Mirko Hirsch? How did you get the Love is Blind, the song? It's very 80s, which I love, because the movie's got an 80s feel.
Love is Blind.
And we're going to play it for everybody because we have time.
Well, actually, we have two different versions of Love is Blind. We have the more pop version in the first one and the more, let's say, love song version in the second one. So I met Mirko actually around Blind, when we shot Blind. And we had a different song on set for the dancing scene, for the dream sequence with Sarah and Jed. We had a different song on set playing, and that was Fade to Grey on Visage. And that is one of my favorite songs of all time. And that is from the 80s. So. I sent that song to Mirko and told him, well, do something which is kind of similar to that one, but put it more about the movie, you know, Blind, Love, blah, blah, blah. And then he created Love is Blind, and that's what it is now.
Everything works. Sarah, question. Where is Joe? Why isn't Joe here?
Well, he starts shooting tomorrow on this new space adventure film, so he's out running errands. We're in very... a deep pre-production, so even I'm like still trying to get things done for today because I start shooting
Friday.
Thank you,
sweetheart. I just want to tell everybody out there, if you're listening and not watching, this show goes on YouTube. All of our shows do. So in about a week or so, look at YouTube and you will be able to see this show in its length, full length, uncensored, all my dirty words are not cut out, thank God. But anyway, so Joe may be able to watch it. So Joe, if you watch it, Joe, you're a good writer. Write something else, something I could be in that has an old man as a wicked person who destroys young people because he's jealous of their youth and he sucks their youth out of them through their mouth. I go, and I become younger. I think that's
more. So let's do Hocus Pocus C then, right?
I think it's been done already, but we could redo it.
So Heather's got to go. We're going to say bye to Heather real quick.
Where are you going, Heather? You have to pee?
No, I don't have to pee, but I appreciate you looking out for me. No, I'm supposed to be on a call that I'm holding up, so I'm going to run off.
No,
congratulations, Heather.
Thank you so much.
Heather,
it's good to see all of you. Everybody have a wonderful...
Congratulations.
Heather, go be a star, Heather. Go be a star.
Thank you. Thank you, boys. Thank you all. Honey. Love you.
All right, so Marcel, what I want you to do, let's play Love is Blind for everybody because we have time. And you would do an introduction for us. Roxy, hopefully you're listening to all of this and you have it ready. And let's play Mirko Hirsch, Love is Blind music video.
I have to say something? Or not?
Yeah, introduce it.
Oh. So yeah, that's Love is Blind. I'm not sure which version you're playing. Maybe the
whichever one is on YouTube is the one we're playing.
Well, it's probably
it's the one from the movie from Blind.
Oh really, Frenchie? So so yeah, that's probably from Pretty Boy. Then the new version that's more a Top Gun version of Love is Blind.
All right, here we go, everybody. Love is Blind from Pretty Boy.
Wow.
Love is Blind.
It sounds like
David. You can get it on vinyl.
Doesn't it sound sounds like David singing for James Bond.
Sarah, like, where do they get it on vinyl?
That is a great, great.
It's through cover. AMD Records. So it's AMD Records. So you just look them up online.
That's a cool thing to have, and then get all you guys from the cast to sign it as a memorabilia. So in like 5 years, when all you guys are bigger than Jamie Lee Curtis, you have it.
But that song is so good, and the cover, the wonderful cover, and it's like David Bowie singing James Bond. Guy sounds like David Bowie over singing. I loved it. It's my kind of music, by the way, not that rap shit that they have today. I can't bear to listen to.
I wonder if anybody, I love rap shit, but.
I can't bear to listen to it for more than 2 minutes.
I like freaking like love it. All right. So you guys listen, love it. Blind is out now. You can see it on all the different platforms.
But wait a minute, James. Let Marcel tell everybody, where can you see it?
Okay, go. Tell everybody again,
tell
Marcel.
Us again, Marcel, because new people have joined us.
Okay, so Blind is out now. It's on Amazon Prime. It's on Tubi TV. It's on iTunes. It's YouTube TV. It's everywhere. So you can...
It's all over.
Yeah, so it's all over. So, and maybe you can catch Pretty Boy if you're in Minnesota somewhere this weekend at the Twin Cities Festival, which I'm really happy about it because that is not a horror festival. It's more about... All
a
movies,
film,
good
a film,
movies,
a film festival.
Yeah, it's great. It's a great festival, and we already showed there Blind 2 years ago. So it's great to be back, and I can't wait to go there. Robert is coming with us. Jet Rowan will be there, and he's get dressed as Pretty Boy. So that's.
I don't know if we give Yay! A shout out to him or not. So we want to give a shout out to Jet, who plays Pretty Boy.
Yeah,
he's phenomenal and a lot of fun. So we want to give him a shout out. Why don't all you guys tell us your Instagram?
I want to say one thing. And again, everybody listening and watching our show, Halloween night, if you're not out in the masquerade begging for candy, stay home. Watch Blind. You will be so happy you did. You will call me and thank me and say, Ron, it was a freaking scary movie. We loved it. It was so Halloween. Please, folks, you know where to go and get it. Marcel, we're old. Tell us again, where can they see your film?
On all
slowly,
the major
slowly,
platforms.
Slowly for the old bags. Slowly.
On all the major platforms, Amazon Prime, Tubi TV.
iTunes.
No, I forgot. Now, look, I'm old. Well, everything okay. Everyone got it.
Google it. You should be able to find it. It'll pop up.
Yeah.
So do yourself a favor. Watch Blind. You will love it, as I and Jimmy do.
So let's go around real quick. Everybody tell us how people can find you in social media, because they got to go, really, some of them.
Well, how can they find Marcel?
No, how can they find each other?
Oh, you can find Marcel on Hollywood Boulevard in Fairfax yeah. around 11 o'clock at night, yeah. under a lamp smoking.
All right, Sarah, tell us your best social media that you like people to follow you on.
You can check me out on Instagram. That's probably the best, at Sarah French Online. And I'm also on Facebook as well.
All right, Marcel.
Well, Instagram is probably the best. It's Marcel Walz Official. And that's, yep, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. I'm not doing Twitter that much. I should do it, but eh. And,
all right.
But yeah.
Sarah Nicklin.
Also Instagram for me, Sarah Nicklin. I'm also on Facebook and Twitter and YouTube, but mostly Instagram.
Everybody's Instagram. Kwame, you told us before, but tell us again, please.
It's Headcase Studios, LLC.
I love it.
And Kwame, if ever I'm on a production and you do my makeup, if you don't make me look 21, I want you to know I keep a handgun in my little thing on the handgun,
that's,
you know.
No.
The guy's here to cut the trees.
I'll blow your fucking brains out.
All right, Robert Felstad.
I'm just on Instagram at BFel2. That's it.
What is it? BFel2?
BFEL and the number 2.
Fucking how would anybody ever find that? Jesus Christ.
That's why I only want, if you know, you know.
Can you hear our dogs?
That's because the lawn guy's here.
The lawn guy is here cutting our lawn. That's why I don't like working from home. It's so much nicer in the studio. And as soon as COVID is over, we go back to a studio.
So anyway, we're going to thank all you guys. We wish you all the best. Congratulations on Pretty Boy. I think it's wonderful. You guys are all, I hope you're all huge stars. Good luck on everybody's newest projects, whatever you guys are doing. Good luck with all of that. And we want to thank you for coming on the show.
Stay
thank
safe.
You guys.
Stay healthy.
Thank you.
Love you guys.
Thanks. Bye, you guys.
Yeah.
Stay safe and stay healthy, please. I love you both. All of you.
Bye.
Bye now. Good show, kids. Good show.
So we